Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Jenny Minto on gender identity healthcare for young people, update and new national standards. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Jenny Minto around 10 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to provide a further update in person to Parliament on this work. I would like to start by speaking directly to trans and non-binary young people in Scotland. I know waiting times to access the specialist services which provide support for gender dysphoria, alongside the ongoing changes to how these services are provided, are worrying for you and your families. I have heard this directly from you in the meetings we've had, and I've read it in the correspondence which I've received from you and those that love you. I also know that high levels of ongoing speculation and interest in these services, along with accompanying and often toxic commentary, whether online, in print or in person, can magnify your worry. I hope this will be borne in mind by those who wish to comment on this sensitive subject. And to those in the Chamber today, it is vital that we lead by example in the tone of our discussions, not just today, but in all our words and work. It is clear from colleagues' correspondence to me that I'm not the only one hearing directly from and listening to young people and their families. Therefore, I'm sure we all agree that they must be our priority and at the heart of all our discussions about how gender identity healthcare is provided and that everyone should be treated with respect. Presiding Officer, in my parliamentary statement in April, I advised that a senior multidisciplinary team in the Office of the Chief Medical Officer would consider the recommendations of the NHS England commissioned CAST review and engage with relevant health boards, and that I would provide an update to Parliament. As a result of that work, the CAST review Implications for Scotland findings report was delivered to Parliament on the 5th of July, the earliest opportunity following the pre-election period. This report is an important milestone in how we work together to deliver better gender identity healthcare for young people in Scotland. The Scottish Government has accepted the findings of the report in full, and work has started to implement its recommendations. One such recommendation is that gender identity healthcare services for young people are, and I quote, not provided in an adult sexual health setting, such as the Sandyford Clinic, but are provided within paediatric clinical settings, as with other age-appropriate services for children and young people. The report also found that to ensure sustainable services, a distributed network or regional model would be the appropriate delivery model instead of one site. We are actioning this at pace to address the immediate fragility of gender identity healthcare for young people and to develop a sustainable longer-term model. We will use the Scottish Government's new planning and commissioning approach to fragile services and are convening a senior task and finish group to take this forward. This work will be overseen by the Chief Operating Officer's Directorate within Scottish Government. Other recommendations from the report have already been implemented by NHS Scotland. For example, access to under-18s gender identity healthcare is now only through referral from a clinician. This is in line with other child or adolescent specialist services and will help ensure any other health needs can be identified and addressed. In a progress report I have published today, there is further detail on the actions taken and progress made so far. This includes the challenges around recruitment and retention of staff in these services, but also the next steps for their commissioning and provision, which will of course include the voices of service users. Presiding Officer, the CMO report and the CAST review underlined the importance of research and data. As I outlined in April, the Scottish Government commissioned Public Health Scotland in 2022 to develop a national data set for NHS gender identity clinics. The first annual data set for both adult and young people's services will be published this autumn. The Parliament is aware we have already provided the University of Glasgow with grant funding to establish a programme of research into the long-term health outcomes of people accessing gender identity healthcare. The first outputs of these projects are expected towards the end of this year. Furthermore, In August, the Chief Scientist for Health for the Scottish Government has confirmed to their counterpart in the UK Department of Health and Social Care the willingness of an NHS Scotland team, which will include the Scottish Government, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and the University of Glasgow, to join the National Institute for Health and Care Research UK-wide study on puberty-suppressing hormones as a treatment option for gender dysphoria. The CMO report also highlighted the need for national standards as well as guidance on training and development for staff. I'm pleased that today Healthcare Improvement Scotland has published their National Standards for Gender Identity Healthcare Adults and Young People. These have been developed following an extensive public consultation as well as targeted consultation with people with lived experience, clinicians and a wide range of professional bodies. They will support clinical services and health boards to deliver positive changes in partnership with people using the services. NHS Education for Scotland's Transgender Care Knowledge and Skills Framework has also been published today. It sets out what NHS staff need to know about to care for trans and non-binary people and to improve training in this area. This framework has also been created following consultation and engagement. Further development of this framework, focusing on staff working with children and young people, has started and is expected to be completed in 2025. Presiding Officer, I have been clear that to get this right, engagement with those involved in services, whether a user or clinician, is vital. Throughout this process, the NHS has engaged constructively with people with lived experience to ensure their voices are represented. And I have regularly and proactively done the same. As well as regularly meeting with young people since becoming a minister last year, later this month I will meet a wide range of stakeholders representing those impacted by ongoing efforts within NHS Scotland to embed better service delivery and ultimately reduce waiting times. I know colleagues across this chamber are doing the same, actively engaged with young people on this topic and committed to making sure their voices are heard. Presiding Officer, I want to reiterate the Scottish Government's wider commitment to improve gender identity healthcare in Scotland for young people and adults. Since December 2022, the Scottish Government has invested over £4.4 million to support gender identity healthcare improvement. Over £3.6 million of this is being allocated directly to NHS boards, providing gender identity clinics to support them to improve service delivery. Independent evaluation of the impact of that investment on waiting times and quality of care is underway. A report will be published this winter and its findings used to support future improvements. We all want to see improvement in waiting times to access these services, and I hope the breadth of work underway and published today illustrates our commitment to improve clinical services and support to the young people who need to access them, and shows that much has been advanced since my last update to this chamber. The CAST review and the CMO Implications for Scotland findings report both recognise that the wider societal discussion about gender identity is complex. They recognise too that the significant public, media and political interest in gender identity healthcare provision for young people may detract from the primary issue of providing the best clinical care necessary for them. This underlines the need for the development of young people's services to, and I quote from the CMO's report, take place with children, young people and their families in an active process of co-production. We all have a responsibility to make sure that children and young people grow up safe, respected and supported. I hope that sentiment is one we can all keep in mind today and in the future.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues arising from her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. For those members wishing to ask a question that haven't already done so, I'd encourage them to press the request to speak buttons and call first Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to the Minister for advance sight of her statement. Tone and language are important when talking about gender identity healthcare, and I echo calls for MSPs to lead by example today. The Minister will be aware that I have held events in Parliament alongside families impacted by gender care. Their stories are harrowing, each outlining the importance of the evidence-based CAS Review Commission. But families and young people have had to wait weeks for a response from the Scottish Government following the Chief Medical Officer's recommendations due to parliamentary recess. During this time, MSPs have not been able to ask direct questions on behalf of their constituents, and I do hope that this is reflected upon. The CAS Review concluded that evidence is lacking to support the use of puberty-suppressing hormones, but it also details that children and young people might not be offered the right psychological support and assessments when experiencing gender distress. Puberty-suppressing hormones have been paused in Scotland, and according to the Cabinet Secretary's statement, a UK-wide study is now underway to assess it as a treatment option. So can I ask the Minister whether puberty-suppressing hormones will continue to be paused here in Scotland until the study has concluded?
Minister.
I thank Megan Gallagher for her question and also the tone of it, and agree wholeheartedly that it's important as we as elected politicians make sure we get our tone correct. And I thank you for meeting with those families impacted. With regard to me giving this statement, I've given it on the first day that we're back in Parliament. We launched or published the Chief Medical Officer's report as soon as we could after the pre-election or, period. I think your direct question regarding puberty blockers, as you will know, that is a reserve power to the UK Government, and we are currently in line with that. And we wait to see what the decisions made by the UK Government. That is MHRA, which is a reserved power, and we will follow that.
Jackie Bailey.
And I thank the Minister for early sight of her statement, and also thank the Chief Medical Officer and his team for their work on the CAS Review Implications for Scotland report. I want to explore waiting times and support for staff. The decision to stop self-referrals and have GPs and other clinicians refer their patients to gender identity clinics has already been announced by the Scottish Government. So can the Minister say what additional resources, such as support and training, will be provided for GPs in what is a very sensitive area of healthcare? Secondly, the waiting times at the Sandiford are long, 4 years if you're a teenager, 5 years if you're an adult. We supported the Scottish Government's strategic action framework 3 years ago when Humza Yousaf was the Health Secretary, but waiting times have continued to rise. I am told there's a recruitment problem at the Sandiford because the environment is toxic, but the position appears to be better at the Chalmers Clinic in Edinburgh. Does the Cabinet Secretary therefore believe that a national service is perhaps the answer to resolve the lack of staff and the increase in waiting times?
Minister.
I thank Jackie Bailey for her question, and as I highlighted in my statement, I do find the waiting times concerning, which is why we have invested additional funding. I talked about the 4.4 million, 3.6 of that going directly. You're right to highlight the differences between the two centres, and I think I also highlighted in my report that there is going to be a review of that funding to see where successes have been made and what the two organisations, the two health boards, can learn from each other. You're also correct to highlight the recruitment issue. That's not just in Scotland, that's UK-wide. And I think, again, leaning back to Megan Gallagher's comment as well, the onus is on us to make sure that we reduce the temperature in these discussions to ensure that the right people with the right training and the right want to ensure that this service works can be recruited and, importantly, retained.
Thank you. To the surprise of nobody, there's an awful lot of interest in this subject, so I'd be grateful for brief questions and brief responses, and all responses should be through the chair. First, Claire Hawkey, to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. As the CAS report stated, a compassionate and kind society remembers there are real children, young people, families, carers and clinicians behind the headlines. And with that in mind, and the long waits that both adults and young people face to access gender identity services, can the Minister advise me what steps the Scottish Government are taking to recruit the staff required to reduce the waiting times?
Minister.
Claire Hawkey for her question. As I responded to Jackie Bailey, since December 2022, we've provided over £4.4 million for gender identity healthcare improvement, including over £3.6 million to health boards providing gender identity clinics. But both the CAST review and the CMO report highlight recruitment in this field is challenging. And as I said in my statement, consideration of staff skills will form part of the already outlined commissioning approach to fragile services, with gender identity healthcare for children and young people now part of that.
Tess White, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
The Royal College of General Practitioners is clear that the prescribing of gender-affirming hormones should generally only be done by specialists, and yet this is often done by GPs who have shared their concerns with me about safe prescribing to patients with gender dysphoria. Under the new standards, can the Scottish Government confirm whether GPs will be routinely expected to prescribe gender-affirming hormones and whether shared care protocols will be put in place?
Minister.
I thank Tess White for her question, and I think we've been clear in our responses that it is the specialist centres that will be in charge of determining the support that children and young people need in this area. We have to ensure we have safe prescribing, which is what the outline and the regulations are creating.
Emma Roddick, to be followed by Carol Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sure the Minister, like me, receives a lot of correspondence from concerned young people and their parents each time that there's news about trans healthcare and puberty blockers and hormones in particular, due to the significant misinformation and misinterpretation of announcements. What the implementation of these recommendations means for people getting treatment will need to be extremely clear and accessible. So can she please provide reassurance to those who are currently receiving treatment or on a waiting list for treatment about the continuation of their care while this research and data collection goes on, and speak to access for such care for those in rural and island communities?
Minister.
I thank Emma Roddick for her question, and we were clear when the announcement was made about the pausing of the prescribing of puberty blockers that those on treatment would remain on that treatment. And representing a rural constituency like Ms Roddick, I absolutely understand what the reasons behind her questions. We are absolutely clear that new national standards are that services should take into account barriers people may face, including those living in island or rural communities. I agree with the multidisciplinary team's report, which states that these services should be delivered according to the principle as local as possible and as national as necessary.
Carol Mochen, to be followed by Fergus Ewan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for today's statement? There is clear disparity in availability of services based on where you live. To ensure sustainable services, there is expectation that gender identity healthcare will be provided in a number of different settings. The report refers to a distributed network or regional model. The Minister's statement says this is being actioned at pace. Can the Minister be clearer on these models and on the timescale in regard to these models?
Minister.
As I responded to Ms Roddick, it is absolutely clear that arrangements should be in place that are suitable for people wherever we live in Scotland. As I said, I represent a rural constituency. We need to ensure that people can access the right care for them at the right time, and this may include the use of digital tools to support people's access to services. If Ms Mochen would allow me, I will come back with a time frame after this question session.
Fergus Ewing, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Presiding Officer, Dr Hilary Cass in her report showed that social transitioning in schools does set some children on a pathway to irreversible medical interventions. Surely children being taught in schools that they're born in the wrong body are being failed in the duty of safeguarding which is owed to each of them. Will the Minister therefore, as numerous of my constituents have called for, withdraw the current guidance, remove all gender ideology references from the relationship, sexual health and parenthood resource, and finally remove third sector activist groups from schools?
Minister.
I thank Fergus Ewing for his question, and if I may just underline that my statement today is focused on NHS gender identity healthcare for young people. These are specialist services provided to a small number of young people who need their care. Children and young people are not taught about their own gender identity in schools. That is a personal matter for any individual, and in the case of young people, their family. However, it is the role of a school to provide pastoral support to a young person who is seeking it. Our education system must support everyone to reach their full potential, and it is vital the curriculum is as diverse as the young people who learn in our schools. It's also vital that we help instill the values of respect and tolerance in our children and young people.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. The current media and political environment means that many young trans people are terrified like never before to come out. Compound that with long waiting times for care and now not being able to access treatment they could this time last year, it's no wonder that many of these young people need mental health support, and I'm glad that this is reflected in the documents that were sent alongside the statement. However, I believe there is a danger with the approach that's currently being proposed, that trans healthcare is seen purely through that lens and that stigma is compounded on one of the most stigmatised groups in society. So how will the Scottish Government ensure that this does not happen, that stigma and transphobia is challenged at every turn, and that this Government is committed to ensuring that their healthcare is accessible and that their rights are upheld?
Minister.
I thank Ms Mackay for her question. As I have said in my statement, all the conversations that I have had in leading up to this have very much included and put the young people and their families at the centre of it. I have a meeting in the next couple of weeks to ensure that the way that we are moving forward is correct. And I think I've said this before, but I will repeat it again. There is a responsibility on those of us that are elected, our newscasters, to ensure that that toxic environment is not kept on.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following on from my colleague's question, the narrative which surrounds the conversation of gender identity healthcare must move away from the harmful, toxic state in which it currently sits. Can the Minister outline work that the Scottish Government will undertake to ensure that the young people at the heart of this discussion are supported positively, both in and out of healthcare environments?
Minister.
I thank Rona Mackay for her question, and as is set out in the progress report published today, a range of support has been put in place for young people accessing and waiting to access gender identity healthcare. This includes waiting list validation and onward referral to additional services where appropriate, as well as community-based third sector support to help address social isolation, inactivity and mental and emotional wellbeing support.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for the tone the Minister has adopted today, and I think she and I share the ambition to get this right in a timely manner and to remove some of the attendant heat that follows it. Emma Roddick rightly referenced the children at the heart of this, many of whom will have care pathways paused, who will have spent several months in profound anxiety about their future. I was very gratified to hear that the government is still seeking an evidential base, and that part of that will be the lived experience of those who have received gender-affirming care. Can I ask what efforts her government will use or deploy to get the voices of those children who are on waiting lists at the heart of those considerations?
Minister.
I thank Alec Cole-Hamilton for his question. I've already indicated that I meet regularly, as do my officials working with me. I think it's also important to recognise, though, that the Scottish Government has also commissioned research through Glasgow University, and part of that research is looking at hypertension and such like in young people. So there's also the research side as well. That's incredibly important to hear the voices of those that we need to hear from.
Rachel Hamilton, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what the Scottish Government statement mean for the future of the Sandyford Clinic? Will it be closed? Will it be relocated? And can she share a timeline for these changes? Could she also confirm if GPs were consulted in the NHS's Education for Scotland Transgender Care Knowledge Skills Framework?
Thank Rachel, you. Minister.
Thank Rachel Hamilton for her question. The the Sandyford Gender Identity Clinic, the Sandyford Clinic is not going to be closed as it offers a wide range of sexual health services. However, the report of the multidisciplinary team has recommended that in future specialist gender identity health services for young people are not provided in an adult sexual health setting but paediatric clinical settings. And as I referenced in my statement, the Scottish Government's new planning and commissioning approach to fragile services work will take place to address the immediate fragility of gender identity health care for young people and develop a sustainable longer-term model in line with the recommendation that these services are delivered in a paediatric setting. And as I indicated as well in my statement, all the reports, all the frameworks that we have published today have had consultation with appropriate people.
Ruth Maguire, to be followed by Ash Reagan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Children and young people with gender dysphoria can present with a range of complex psychosocial challenges and mental health problems which can impact on their gender-related distress. Can parents and children in Scotland now be reassured, with services being provided in paediatric settings, that all issues will be explored fully in order to provide diagnosis, clinical support and interventions, medical or otherwise, which are appropriate for the age, stage and needs of the child or young person?
Minister.
I thank Ruth Maguire for that very important question, and it is of the utmost importance that these services are delivered to the highest standard for the young people that use them. New national standards I have referenced include a standard, which is standard number 10, to specifically address the delivery of gender identity services for young people and outline the need for young people to have timely access to safe, high-quality and person-centred gender identity services which understand, respect and uphold their rights.
Ash Reagan, to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Adult and child patients must have healthcare appropriate to their clinically assessed medical presentation. So can the Government confirm what the milestones will be for Scotland's CAS compliance for the 32 recommendations? And what clinical evidence informed the national standards? And can the Minister confirm that GPs and primary care clinicians and health boards fully support these national standards and their funding, training and implementation, as reports that are reaching me suggest that this is not the case?
Minister.
Thank Ash Reagan for her question, and a clear ask of the Chief Medical Officer and his multidisciplinary team was to review the recommendations in the CAS review to ensure that they were being properly implemented as appropriate in Scotland, and that's what I've been reporting on today. There is also the progress statement too. Clinical organisations were consulted. I'm not across the information about health boards complaining or raising issues, so perhaps Ms Reagan would be happy to write to me on that, and I'm very happy to explore it.
And Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Following on from the questions that have been asked by Tess White, Fergus Ewing, Rachel Hamilton and Ash Reagan, would the Minister take this opportunity to spell out the governance structure for the oversight of Scottish gender identity services? In other words, who is responsible?
Minister.
So responsibility for all healthcare lies with the health boards, and the Scottish Government work with them to ensure that that is met. We have had very clear consultation across the board, including GPs, to ensure that the four reports that have been published today provide the right standards for Scotland to move forward with regard to gender identity healthcare.
Thank you, and can I thank all members for their cooperation. We managed to get everybody in that wanted to get in. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.